Dear students, assalamu alaikum. This is lecture number 3 for 4th week and for 2nd term. In previous two lectures, in lecture number 1 and lecture number 2 of this 4th week, we talked about equations of motion. Then we derived first equation of motion and second equation of motion graphically. Let's have a recap of the previous two lectures. Equations of motion. There are three basic equations of motion for bodies moving with uniform acceleration. These equations relate initial velocity, final velocity, acceleration, time, and distance covered by a moving body. We have seen that the first equation is Vf equal Vi plus At. And this equation relates final velocity, initial velocity, acceleration and time. Similarly, the second equation is equal to S equals VIT plus 1/2 AT squared. So this equation relates distance, initial velocity, time and acceleration. Dear students, in today's discussion, we talked about questions from the exercise, and these are given at page number 52 and 53. So let's start. Question number 2.1. Encircle the correct answers from the given choices. Number 1. A body has translatory motion if it moves along a. There are 4 options given, and the correct option is C. So, a body has translatory motion if it moves along a line without rotation. Number 2. The motion of a body about an axis is called. Again, there are 4 options given, and the correct option is B. So, the motion of a body about an axis is called rotatory motion. Number 3. Which of the following is a vector quantity? So you see 4 options: A, speed; B, distance; C, displacement; and D, power. So out of these 4 options, C is correct. So which of the following is a vector quantity? Displacement. Number 4. If an object is moving with constant speed, then its distance time graph will be a straight line. So analyze and elaborate this situation. Here it is given that it is speed time graph. I mean, this is time axis and this is distance. Distance is shown by D. So this is distance time graph. And you know, if it graphs looks like this is the origin, this one. So here we see that with equal intervals of time, if equal distances are covered, we say that it's a speed, it's a constant speed. So provided this graph, which is the correct option? D. So we say that if an object is moving with constant speed, then its distance time graph will be a straight line inclined to time axis. Number 5. A straight line parallel to time axis on a distance time graph tells that the object is. Here again there are 4 options given, and the correct option is B. Let's see. Let's make it clear from the graph. It is distance time graph. This is horizontal time axis and this is vertical distance axis. And it is given that a straight line parallel to time axis. Mean this. So here we see that with the passage of time, the distance is not changing. So this is the situation where the body is at rest. Number six, the speed time graph. Our car is shown in the figure. Which of the following statement is true? Here you see that this is the graph and this is the speed time graph. And you see that initially, meaning this is the origin, meaning this is the point when an observer starts observing the motion of a body. Initially, the body gets some speed, it is 15 meter per second, and with the passage of time, this axis is time axis, so with the passage of time, the body gets decelerated, shown by this negative slope, and after time, 10 seconds, the body gets at rest, mean it is stopped. So this is the situation given. So dear students, as you know, while driving the second equation of motion, we got an idea that in speed time graph, the shaded area between the graph and the time axis give you the distance. So it's a triangular region, it is clear like this. So if you use the area of a triangle, you can find the distance, and you know distance equal the area of this triangle. This is the triangular shape, and you know what's the area of the triangle? 1/2 times base, and base is 10, and height is 15. And if you simplify, arithmetic manipulation gives you 75 meter. So the correct option is C. Number seven, which of the following graph is representing uniform acceleration? And if you notice, observe the graphs. Graph A is actually it is inclined like this. Mean with the passage of time, the distance is traveled by a body. So it's a sort of uniform speed. And you know, in uniform speed, there is no acceleration. If you analyze this B graph, the graph looks like this, and it is parallel to the time axis. Mean with the passage of time, the body is not changing its position. So it's a graph of a body which is at rest. Similarly, this C here, we notice that it's a speed time graph, and we notice that with passage of time, the body gets decelerated, mean it is retarded, its speed is slows down like this. And in fourth graph, you see that again it's a speed time graph, and it's a variable speed. Initially it's not changing uniformly. So the correct option is C. Here we note that the speed of the body is decreasing uniformly. Mean in equal intervals of time, the speed of the body is decreasing equally. Mean uniform change in speed, and uniform change in speed equals to uniform acceleration. So C is the option. Number eight, by dividing displacement of a moving body with time, we obtain, here the correct option is C, velocity. You know, velocity equals displacement divided time. So this is the basic formula for velocity. Mean rate of change of displacement gives you the velocity. So C is the correct option. In MCQ number 9, a ball is thrown vertically upward, its velocity at the highest point is. You know, whenever a body is thrown upward, its velocity decreases because the body is going against the gravity. And then it returns back. So, at this highest point, the body becomes stationary, meaning it rests for a fraction of a second, then comes back. So whenever the body gets stopped while moving, its final velocity is zero. So here the correct option is B. Mean a ball is thrown vertically upward, its velocity at the highest point is zero. Next, number 10, a change in position is called, the option is C, displacement. Dear students, here the close options were distance D and C, displacement. So you should be clear about them. Here the option is change in position. A change in position is to be found out. And you know, suppose the body starts from point A and it goes to B and then it is returning C and finally it comes to A. So here you note that the body, after covering some distance, reaches again to its initial position. So here body must have traveled through some distance AB, BC and CA, but after reaching again at A, the body is not being displaced. So there is no change in position. So the appropriate option is C, displacement. And this is the basic definition for displacement. A change in position is called displacement. Number 11, a train is moving at a speed of 36 km per hour. Its speed expresses in meter per second is, mean we have to convert 36 km per hour. So we have to convert it into a meter per second. So it is 36, kilo is the prefix, mean 1000. So we multiply by 1000. And this per hour is in denominator. So how many seconds are there in 1 hour? 3600. So this is meter per second. Now arithmetic simplification is there. These two zeros have been cancelled out. 36 is cancelled out with 36 and we are only left with 10. So 36 km per hour equals 10 meter per second. So correct option is A, 10 meter per second. So this conversion is very important. Number 12 and last one is, a car starts from rest. It acquires a speed of 25 meter per second after 20 seconds. The distance moved by the car during this time is. So this is a sort of numerical problem. So let's see what type of data is given. A car starts from rest, mean initial velocity is zero. It acquires a speed of 25 meter per second after 20 seconds, mean this is VF is given. 25 meter per second and time is 20 second. So distance moved, S is to be found. So dear students, I have solved this numerical in lecture number 2. So you can get the concept from that slide, that discussion. So after manipulation, I mean second equation is to be utilized. I just write it VIT plus 1/2 AT squared. So if you plug the values here and you are to find the acceleration A, you would be having 250 meter. So the correct option for this MCQ number 12 is B. Dear students, after discussing MCQs at page number 52 and 53, let's talk about short response questions at page number 53. Here 2.2, explain translatory motion and give example of various types of translatory motion. So simply, translatory motion is defined as, this is the definition of the translatory motion. In translational motion, a body moves along a line without any rotation. The line may be straight or curved. Mean a body may be having a rectilinear motion or curvilinear motion. So here in figure 2.3, you see that this is a sort of object which is moving along this path, which is shown here. You see that the orientation of the body remains same. Mean it is only translating and not rotating. So this is a translatory sort of motion. So object shown in the figure 2.3 moves along a curved path without rotation. This is the translatory motion of an object. So the other types of translatory motion are a car moving in a straight line. Similarly, an aeroplane moving straight is a translational motion. And translational motion, you know, can be further categorized as linear motion, circular motion, and random motion. We talked about it when we were talking, we were discussing this chapter in some previous discussions. Question number 2.3, differentiate between the following. Dear students, we already talked about rest and motion, circular motion and rotatory motion, distance and displacement, speed and velocity, linear and random motion. So at this point, let's only talk about scalars and vectors. So the definition of scalar is given here. A scalar quantity is described by its magnitude only. Mean a scalar quantity only requires a magnitude. For example, mass, length, time, speed, volume, work, energy, etc. All these sort of physical quantities are only represented or described by their magnitude. So this is scalar quantity. Now come to the vector quantity. Definition of vector quantity is given here. A vector quantity is described completely by magnitude and direction. Mean vector quantities are those quantities which require both magnitude, mean numerical quantity, and direction. Examples of vectors are velocity, displacement, force, momentum, torque, etc. Question number 2.4. Define the terms speed, velocity, and acceleration. Dear students, we already talked about them. Speed is simply the distance covered by an object in unit time is called its speed. Speed is symbolized by V and it is equal to S by T. This is the formula for speed. Similarly, velocity is defined as the rate of displacement of a body is called its velocity. And the formula for velocity is a vector quantity, so we can put an arrow here over the V. Similarly, this is the displacement, which is the vector meter. So this is the mathematical form for velocity. Similarly, acceleration is defined as the rate of change of velocity of a body. So acceleration is A and it's a vector and it's equal to change in velocity, mean Vf minus Vi, this is the change in velocity divided by time. So this is rate of change of velocity. Question 2.5, can a body moving at constant speed have acceleration? The answer is yes. What's the situation? When a body is moving with constant speed, the body can have acceleration if its direction changes. For example, if the body is moving along a circle with constant speed, it will have acceleration due to the change of direction of every instant. Here, dear student, here you must be clear about the concept. If a body is moving in a straight line with constant speed, then the body has no acceleration. But if a body is moving along a curvy linear motion, then whether it gets a constant speed or not, because it is changing its direction, that's why a body having constant speed in a along a curvature, mean along a curved path, for example circle, has a circle, mean if a body is moving in this direction like this, so the body gets the acceleration due to change in direction. Question number 2.6. How do riders in a Ferris wheel possesses translatory motion but not rotatory motion? Dear students, although this is the figure in which a Ferris wheel is shown, riders moving in a Ferris wheel, such as shown in figure 2.4, are also in translational motion. Their motion is in a circle without rotation. Although the system is rotating like this, but if you notice individual container like this, these four containers are given, are shown here, you see that these are moving in a circle without rotation. That's why the rider moving in a Ferris wheel only possesses translatory motion but not rotatory motion. Question number 2.7. Sketch the distance time graph for a body starting from rest. How will you determine the speed of a body from this graph? So let's draw distance time graph. Here you see that this horizontal axis is time axis and this vertical axis is distance, and it is given that the body starts from rest. So this is the origin, and the body, mean the graph of the body may be like this. Okay, so this is the graph for a distance time graph for a body starting from rest. Dear students, you know that the slope of distance time graph give you the speed. So if the graph looks like this, then you can have a slope like this. I mean, this is the slope. You only consider these two points, mean A, B. Then slope of this graph, slope of these two points A, B give you the speed, and you can easily find it by taking this rise in perpendicular side divided by this run in horizontal side or base. Or you can say that if you join the distance axis, these two points, this is D1 and this is D2. Similarly, drop the perpendicular on time axis, this is T1 and this is T2. So how to get speed? Speed equals D2 minus D1, mean change in distance, divided by T2 minus T1. So this is how to find speed of a body from this graph. 2.8. What would be the shape of a speed time graph of a body moving with variable speed? There are different situations. For example, you can understand by this graph. This is time, horizontal axis, this is speed. Now suppose the body takes from rest, initially its velocity increases, then at certain point the graph looks like this, in parallel to time axis, when now speed is constant, and then body gets decelerated and find it stops. So here you see that increase in speed. Here you see that there is no change in speed, mean constant speed. And in third stage you see that the decrease in speed. So this is one of the options of the graph of speed time graph showing a body moving with variable speed. Question number 2.9. Which of the following can be obtained from speed time graph? Number 1, initial speed. Number 2, final speed. Number 3, distance covered in time t. Number 4, acceleration of motion. The answer is all the above factors can be obtained on the speed time graph. For example, if you consider this graph, suppose this is the same graph we applied in driving equation number 1 and equation number 2 of motion. So suppose here the speed increases like this. Here you see that this is the origin, and initially body gets the initial velocity vl, and after some time body is having increase in velocity vf. So initial velocity and final velocity are shown here, and then you know that the slope of this speed time graph give you the acceleration. So this slope give you the acceleration. So acceleration can also be calculated, and we can also find the distance covered in time, as we talked about, discussed in case of driving second equation of motion. We have distance, this shaded area under the curve, and we got the distance. So all these four factors, mean initial speed, final speed, distance covered in time t, and acceleration of motion can be obtained from speed time graph. 2.10. How can vector quantity be represented graphically? Graphically, a vector quantity is represented by an arrow having some length, mean magnitude, and this arrowhead shows the direction. And usually we represent a vector by a letter and an arrow over it. It may be in any direction or it may be of any length. Suppose this is the B vector. So this is how to represent a vector graphically with the help of an arrow. 2.11. Why vector quantities cannot be added and subtracted like scalar quantities? You know, scalar quantities are only having magnitude, and vector quantities require both magnitude and direction. So the answer is the scalar quantities obey the rules of arithmetic and ordinary algebra, because scalar quantities have no direction. So vectors obey special rules of vectors algebra. Therefore vectors are added by head to tail rule, that is vector algebra. That's why we say that vector quantities cannot be added and subtracted like scalar quantities due to additional characteristics of direction. 2.12. How are the vector quantities important to us in our daily life? So the answer, there may be multiple answers. Out of them, we can say that we use vectors in almost every activity of life. A vector is a quantity that has both direction and magnitude. Examples of everyday activities that involve vector include, number one, here I have added some examples. Breathing, your diaphragm muscles exert a force that has magnitude and direction. Number two, walking, you walk at a velocity around 7 km/h in a direction of the wherever, whatever the position you get. Number three, going to school, the bus has length of about 300 meters and is headed towards your school. Number four, lunch, the displacement from your classroom to canteen is about whatever you can say 50 meter in north direction, let's say. Number 5, to describe a car's velocity, you would have to state it as some magnitude, mean 80 km per hour towards what direction, south or whatever. So vectors are important as they describe physical processes in the real world, and without understanding them, we cannot understand how real world works. Imagine how difficult it would be for an air traffic controller if it did not understand vectors when directing planes, speeds and direction. So these examples signifies the importance of vectors in our daily life. There may be much, much more examples can be quoted here. 2.13. This question demands derive equations of motion for uniformly accelerated rectilinear motion. And we have derived equation number 1 and equation number 2 by speed time graph. You have seen that this is speed time graph and this is the graph of the moving body, and this is initial velocity, and after some time t, you see that after some time t, the body gets velocity vf. So this speed time graph, with the help of this speed time graph, we have derived equation number 1 given as vf is equal to vi plus at. And similarly, if we make more complete this graph, then we get the areas, the shaded area, mean area of triangle and area of rectangle. So this gives you the distance, and this is this second equation of motion. So we have derived these two equations with the help of this speed time graph. Here 2.14, sketch the velocity time graph for the motion of a body. From the graph, explain each step to calculate distance covered by body. So as an example, I have added figure 2.25, and you notice that there are three phases of this graph. Initially, the speed of the body increases from 0 to this 16 meter per second and reaches at point A. And then from A to B, the speed of the body remains constant, mean it remains constant for 18 seconds. So, and then in the last stage, it decreases from B to C and body becomes stationary, mean it comes at rest. So here you note that this is 28. And this is 30. So here you notice that this is speed time graph, and to calculate the distance from speed time graph, we are to consider the area under speed time graph like this. So this is the area, shaded area, and it looks like a trapezium. So total distance traveled equal area under the graph, trapezium OABC. So what's the formula for the area of trapezium? 1/2 sum of parallel side times height. And you notice that these two are parallel sides, OC and AB. So AB equal 18 second and OC equal 30 second, as shown by this time axis. Then height is, it's very visible that it is 16 meter. So after arithmetic simplification, we get 384 meter. So this is the distance covered by a body, which is represented by this graph. Dear students, alternatively, you can also utilize these three areas, this area of a triangle, area of this rectangle or square, again area of this triangle. So if you sum these three areas of two triangles and one rectangle, you can also get the same answer. So there are two ways to get the distance covered by a body from the velocity time graph. Either you apply the whole area as a trapezium or you break down the areas into different shapes. For example, here two triangles and one rectangle is there. So there's a very simple way to get the distance from speed time graph. Mean area under curve gives you the distance. Dear students, this is all about regarding to this discussion. We actually solved the exercise questions from page number 52 and 53 of your textbook, and we solved the MCQs, then short response questions. We completely talked about them. Some have already been talked about in previous sections, some are new to you. So hopefully this would be a very important and beneficial for you. So see you. These are three lectures for this week 4, and we are having next week 5th week of second term, and see you with more 3 lectures for next 5th week. So take care of yourself and see you next time with next discussion. Goodbye, students.